Good evening. Welcome to tonight's On the Edge with me, Theo Chalmers. My guest tonight is someone with a well-tuned sense of what is right and what is wrong with our world. Fortunately, she's also someone who is prepared to put her money where her mouth is, to bring her and others' research and beliefs to a much wider audience. She is the author of two books, one concentrating more on the spiritual revolution we may be experiencing, called Soul Companions, and her latest work, based on the same interview theme, entitled The Dangerous Man, Conversations with Free Thinkers and Truth Seekers, a Collection of Alternative Research, for which she interviewed 32 of the most brilliant and controversial minds of our time. These include David Icke, Michael Tesarian, Ralph Ellis, Clive Baxter, Bruce Lipton, Paul Levy, Peter Taylor, Neil Haig, Michael Cremo, Ian R. Crane, Mary Croft, Winston Shrout, Robert Mannard, John Harris, Jonathan Goldman, Jerry E. Smith, Alan Cantwell, Alan Wilson, Ellis C. Taylor, Kevin B. Miller, Daniel Tatman, and Red Ice Creations, several of whom have been guests on this show. As if this wasn't enough, she's also the organizer of the ARC Convention, which took place in Bath, Somerset in February. The second ARC Convention is on August the 28th to the 29th at the same venue. My guest tonight, then, is the remarkable Karen Sawyer. What a show we've got tonight. Karen,
Thank
welcome.
Thank you for the introduction.
You liked that, did you? It was quite a long one, wasn't it?
A bit of a mouthful.
But we got through it okay, I think. So, here you are from Bath or thereabouts.
Pembrokeshire, really. Via Bath.
Yes. Well, I'm quite familiar with Pembrokeshire. It's a fabulous place. They call it Little England, don't they, actually?
Yeah.
Lots of mountain walks and so on, cliff walks.
Yeah, very lot of sacred sites. Too many to plot, I feel.
Okay, well, let's not talk about Pembrokeshire. Let's talk about you and how you got into this. How did you get into, I suppose, what might be loosely described as the truth movement?
Via Soul Companions, I suppose, and writing that book.
This is that book.
That book.
Soul Companions.
And actually kind of being on a bit of a search for what our indigenous elders, who they were, you know, and having kind of got into Native American spiritual practices and lots of other different ways from different cultures, and particularly sort of shamanic things, and looking into those for myself, you know,
and resonating. What, for your own spiritual development?
Yeah, kind of resonating with those and finding out about stuff, and then kind of curiously thinking, well, what about ours? Where's our sacred teachings? And we have these fantastic monuments here in the UK, you know?
Like Stonehenge, you mean?
Yeah.
Is that the sort of thing you're referring to?
But really, I mean, per square mile, we've probably got more sacred sites than any other place, which is quite strange because we're only a tiny little blip of an island compared to the rest of the world.
But I suppose over the generations, we made a lot of money and conquered lots of lands and stole all their wealth and had to do something with it, so I suppose you might as well build the odd monument.
Yeah, I guess. So this is the thing. It was kind of my search for what the truth was, really. And that became something else. And so while I was looking for answers, spiritual answers, I was also finding information, and stuff came along through David Icke's website initially, I think, quite a lot of research I did.
The way you've done this book is, they sort of write it themselves in a sense, don't they? It's like they're talking in the first person very often.
Yeah, they're talking in the first person because they're talking to me and therefore talking to everyone else, because then everything they say to me, I transcribe each word, even the ums and everything you get in a normal conversation. And it's not a linear, a conversation is not a linear thing. It really is not.
It's not, that's right. I've interviewed people and transcribed it afterwards, and it's not sentences, is it? It's choppy bits.
Yeah, hodgepodge. And then what you find is that you talk in circles. So when you're writing it up as something, you want to So what I've done then is I've transcribed it, and I did have a hand. A few people helped me do the transcriptions, which was really good.
Yeah.
It used to take a hell of a long time.
And then they all approved their bits, did they, afterwards?
Yeah, once I've edited it, yeah. And so basically I've taken this whole kind of random conversation and put it together in a way that flows.
Okay.
And I think there's a knack to that. I seem to have a knack at putting
yes,
things together.
Yes, you do, yes. I've got a text in already from Steve in High Wycombe.
Okay.
He says, I recently attended the art conference in Bath and had a great time.
Aww.
Amazing stuff.
It
Looking
was.
Forward to August.
Excellent.
Cheers, he says.
Yeah, it was fab. It was. Yeah.
And this was the first one, wasn't it, that you did? And some of the people who were in this book were your guests there, people like...
Yeah, Michael Tesarian was my guest of honour. Yeah, it was so good to meet him. Well, everyone, really. It was fantastic. Ralph Ellis.
Uh-huh.
I can't even think off the top of my head.
Alan Wilson.
Yeah. Leo Rutherford.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. There was a panel discussion. I really wanted it to be... a meeting. I wanted everyone to share their ideas, and I wanted that personal interaction between everyone who took part, not just everyone who came to it. And so it worked really well, yeah.
So so you put this together. Well, you did the book first.
Yeah.
And this has been out for how long? No, it's very new, isn't it? It's only been out...
Literally about a week before the convention happened.
Oh, right.
It was a bit touch and go, yeah.
You like leaving things to the last minute.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm not going to tell everybody.
I think it's a spontaneity that you can't really. I mean, you know, I like that. I like things to be fresh and, you know.
Okay.
Generally.
So okay, you started interviewing these people, and I think there are something like 35 in this one.
There's 33.
33 in this.
It's the special Masonic number.
Really?
And there's 6 chapters.
Yes, that's right. They deal with different headings, don't they? There's the dangerous man, dangerous creations, dangerous science, dangerous environment, dangerous history, and dangerous corporation.
I don't know if anyone's actually twigged that the 6, the relevance to that is Patrick McGoohan, because his character...
Oh, I'm not a number, I'm a free man.
He is number 6.
They're remaking The Prisoner, kind of, aren't they?
I don't know about
or
that.
Or remade it. No, I don't know about that either.
But I mean, it was perfect the first time round. I don't really see how you can improve on that, to be honest with you.
It was. Yeah. I remember watching it thinking, what's it about?
I know. It was fantastic.
And I don't think he knew, really.
No, I was wondering about that. Did he know how the ending was going to kind of turn out right from the beginning, you know?
Yeah.
Or was it, I don't know. We'll never know, will we? He's taken that to the grave.
Well, he's gone.
But yeah, I mean, that was weird because he died while I was writing the book. And I'd written to him asking him, would he write the foreword? And then about a month later, he was gone. And I kind of had this like romantic idea in my head that he was just writing it on his deathbed. Maybe I might get it in the post, but no, it didn't happen. So.
Because actually, I don't know if you know this, but your book is called The Dangerous Man.
Oh, and Danger Man.
Danger Man.
I know, well, I didn't
that
know
that. That was his
that.
First series, wasn't it?
I honestly did
it?
Not know that at the time, and then I found out afterwards, it was like, what, that's just strange. So, yeah, I mean, there's a lot of funny things like that happen.
Spheres are moving in strange ways.
Yeah.
So, OK, you interviewed all these people, 33 people.
Mm-hmm.
And what do you think you got out of it?
God, that's a question, isn't it?
Yeah.
I think what I got out of it was a lot of information, some really excellent friends, actually, and which to me was more important, really, than anything else. It was just a wonderful experience, really, just to kind of hear all these other different points of view. I mean, I've got my own kind of take on things anyway. Not that that's fixed in stone, but it's just intriguing to kind of look into what someone else is saying. I don't necessarily agree with every single person and what they've written, you know?
Well,
and I'm not going to say who I agree with and who I don't, because I don't think that's fair either.
No, I don't think it's fair either. And I think that's a very good place to be.